Good evening, everyone. Great, Dr. Sam. How are you? Good evening, Brenda Carter. How are you? Blessings to you. That's great to hear. Good evening to everyone coming in. God bless you. God bless you. Good to see you too. Well, to see your words, because I don't see you. Blessings, Reverend. Thank you for joining us tonight, Elder Watson. Holy Spirit, breathe on us. Good evening, good evening, good evening. I am Elder Jason Williams. I am not Bishop Reginald C. Witherspoon Sr. He is out of town today and has requested that I sit in his proxy, and I consider this a privilege to sit and be before the people that God has chosen for him to lead, and those that are friends and family of his, to be able to just say a little something. Don't be weary, because a bishop will be back, I'm sure, next week. And he will definitely be expecting to see all of your faces in and on this platform. Tonight, I'm not going to be long. I'm just going to go through a quick little story. But when we look at where we are in society, when we look at what we are facing with the things that are going on, I know this is like a biblical cliche where most people would say, you know, the times we live in, if you take Revelations and you look at the time that we live in, you will see those things seem to be matching up quite nicely. But the good news is that those that are in the family of faith, those that are children of God, I started to say those that are confessing to be children of God, but everybody confessing, it doesn't mean that you are. But everybody that is a child of God knows that the time is running short. The time is coming to an end, and apparently swiftly. And with that being said, there are so many things going on, so many mental states that people find themselves in. There are so many things that we can find ourselves distracted and distraught in and under. So I just wanted to speak to the hearts of people that may have lost a little hope, may have lost a little faith, and may have lost that because you just lost your way. You made a said, done, thought, and even for those that didn't, but just feels like, you know, I'm not sure what I'm supposed to do next. I'm gonna tell you a little story about a man named Peter. Peter just so happened to be one of the apostles, one of the disciples of Jesus Christ. And also, Peter happens to be one of the close ones to Jesus. And at the time, or right before the time of Jesus being taken in into the courts and being tried and everything else that would happen to him on that night, there was a supper that they were having. And while they were having that last supper, Jesus said some things that kind of rocked the disciples, and they weren't sure exactly what he meant by what he said. But there was one thing about Peter. Peter was like, I'll say like this. Peter was like that special child. Not special in the sense of that there was anything wrong with him, but he was that special child that he could go from being super good to being super bad all in the same breath. He was that person that, you know, one minute he could quote scripture and speak in tongues and lay on hands, and then the next minute he'd be ready to fight or cuss you out. That was Peter. Peter did what he felt like he had to do when he had to do it. And it didn't matter what was going on or who was around. Peter was one of those that, you know, it's always good to have a Peter. I'll just say that. It's always good to have a Peter around because you never know when you might need a Peter. But Peter was that child for Jesus that had great understanding when the Spirit led him, he would say whatever it is that the Spirit led him to say. But then he would also say those things which weren't 100% of the Spirit. And I know a lot of us can relate to that, because there are times where life and circumstances sometimes causes us, or we allow life, let me say it like this, we allow life and circumstances to cause us to sometimes act out of the character we know we should be walking or acting in. We allow our lives to sometimes mirror those things we used to be and not the things that we should be. we allow our lives to be distracted by what's in front of us and not by what we already know. Now, if we go to Matthew 26 specifically, if you go to Matthew 26 and 31, Jesus says to Peter, I tell you the truth, this very night, before the rooster crows, you will, and this is just a different version of the Bible, you will disown me three times. But Peter declared, even if I have to die with you, I will never disown you. And the other disciples said the same. Now, isn't that amazing? You know who Jesus is. You have a relationship with this man. You've seen him do miracles upon miracles. You've seen him say things and they come to pass. And he says to you, first statement is, I tell you the truth. This very night, before the cock crows, you will disown me or deny me three times. Now, you would think Peter would have said, Lord, please forgive me first. But his first response, like I said, Peter was a special child. Even if I have to die with you, I will never disown you. I will never deny you. And the crazy thing is, when they were in the Garden of Gethsemane, when Jesus was about to be snatched by the guards, Peter lived up to that creed. He reached out his sword and he cut a man's ear off because he was reaching for Jesus. Once again, like I said, Peter was that kid. He was that child that in the circumstance, in that particular circumstance, he was willing to go for whatever he had to go for to prove that he loved Jesus. In that circumstance. But on that same night, when he had to see Jesus go through the courts and how they were treating him and what they were saying about him, something in his mind clicked. Because that very night, a woman said, hey, weren't you one of them that was with Jesus? Oh, no, not me. Mm-mm. Not that one. Mm-mm. Not me. Wasn't me. He was doing like Shaggy. Wasn't me. Then another woman came and said, yeah, that was you. That was you with him. He said, nah, look, I told you once now. It's not me now. Leave me alone. Leave me alone about this. Then he was asked one more time. And this time, Peter had to curse somebody out. The Bible says he cursed and he sweared. So he put the double whammy on them to let them know, no, you got me confused. Because the last statement they said was, your speech betray you. Now, the crazy thing is, the fact that they could say your speech betray you means he spent a lot of time with Jesus. How many of you know that the only way your speech seems to match someone else's is that either you are in the same family or you've spent so much time with each other that y'all sound alike. Look at your best friends. You know certain things about your best friends so much so that y'all can finish each other's sentences. You can say something and your best friend knows exactly where you're going with it. And a lot of times, you all say the same types of things in certain circumstances because you've spent so much time together, you almost think the same. That's where Peter was. He had such a relationship with God that he was recognized to be with Jesus by the way he spoke. which means something about Jesus had rubbed off on him to the point where he represented Jesus even when he was trying not to. Isn't that a great place to be in God? Wouldn't you think that would be the place we all want to be? In a place where no matter where we went, no matter what we did, no matter what we said, it sounded like God. I don't know about you, but that's the place I would like to be in. I would like to be in that place where everything I said sounded like the voice of God. Everything I did looked like the mirrored image of God. Where people that don't know that I know God, but they have an inkling of who God is, can see God through me. I believe that's the place we all want to be. I believe that's the place that we all are striving to get to. But just like Peter, there are some circumstances that come in your life that sometimes will cause you to act out in a way that does not represent God and honestly denies that he's a part of even your life. And I'm not saying this to try to drive home perfection. Because me, I confess just like Paul, I am probably the chief of sinners. I don't know everybody. I don't know everybody's situation. But I know what I know about me. And what I know about me is I ain't perfect. Far from it. But I'm striving towards the perfection of my soul in Christ. Do I dot every I? Do I cross every T? No, not at all. But I am trying my best to follow after the path that Jesus left. I can't allow what I have in front of me, the circumstances, the situation, the heat of a problem, to cause me to forget who Jesus said I am, who Jesus said I would be. Now, Jesus said many things about Peter. He said that flesh and blood could not reveal this to you, when Jesus declared who he was. But in the same breath had to say, get behind me, Satan, because he wanted to build a monument. He told Peter, the devil, I pray that the devil does not sift you because he desires to sift. He says, I pray for you because the devil desires to sift you as wheat. And then here he said that you're going to deny me three times. And Peter fought against that. Peter said, no, God, I'll never do that against you. And Jesus, being who he is, proved him wrong. Now, I'm not saying all of this to make anybody feel guilty, to make anybody feel any type of way. But I'm saying this because I know for me, I have been in those situations where my representation wasn't that of Christ. And I have to repent and ask God to forgive me for my representation. Because, yes, I consider myself a child of God. And just like my daddy used to tell us when we were kids, you know, when you go out, you represent the Williams' name, my name. So when you go out, you remember whose you are. Now, he would end it with, because if you don't, I'll help you when you get home. Because trust me, he was a hard taskmaster. But the realities of his statement are true even spiritually. When we go out into the world, when we go out to our jobs, when we're just out hanging out in the streets, who do you represent? It's not about where you go as much as it is about who you represent when you go. Jesus found himself amongst many different types of people. But the people did not affect who Jesus was. Jesus affected every area he went into. He changed lives no matter what scenario he found himself in. The scenario didn't change Jesus, but Jesus changed the scenario. So I know some people say, well, you shouldn't go there. You shouldn't go here. You shouldn't go there. And there's some places, if you have a weakness, don't step your foot in it. Because I know people like to use the scripture, how can light and darkness walk together? And I think sometimes they misconstrue that. Because yes, light and darkness cannot walk together, because as soon as light comes in, there is no more darkness. If you don't believe me, turn off all your lights, go in your closet, and turn on your cell phone. Darkness leaves. But the reality of that statement is, that's saying I'm joining myself with darkness. But how can the darkness of the world see the light if light never comes? If I don't allow my light to shine in places that are dark, then how can the darkness see the light without the light shining in darkness? Now, that's a whole nother subject matter. Not going to talk about that tonight. Just wanted to throw that out there. Because if I get into that one, we won't get where I'm trying to go. But Jesus was telling Peter he would deny him three times. Peter didn't believe it until it happened. Because after the third time, the cock crow. The rooster crowed. I'll say it like that. The rooster crowed. And everything that Jesus had said to him came back to his remembrance. Now, as the story goes, Jesus dies. And he's raised up again in 3 days. And after those 3 days, he was walking around, showing himself to people, disappearing, showing himself to people, disappearing. All the stories were going out. And Peter found himself in what I would call a place of depression. Because if you go to John, and in the 21st chapter, you'll find there Peter was with the disciples. A few of them. Can't remember all of their names at this point, but he had a few of the disciples with him. And they were just hanging out. And Peter said, you know what? I'm going fishing. That's what I know. That's what I know to do. That's what I do well. I'm going fishing. And they said, you know what, brother? We're going with you. Now, the thing about Peter and fishing is that's what he did for a living before he met Jesus. Jesus told them, when he first met them, that you are fishermen, but I'm about to make you fishers of men. And they followed Jesus for 3 years. Wherever he went, they went. Whatever he did, they were there. For 3 years, left fishing off to the side. Because now I have a new mission. I'm fishing for men, for the lives and the souls of men. That's my new job. But Peter denied Jesus three times and got lost in the struggle. How many of you have ever been in a position where you felt like, man, I just don't know what to do now? I don't know which path to walk down. because I could go down this road, but it's unclear because I've made some mistakes. I didn't do everything I should have done. I didn't get that college degree. I had a child at an early age, so my struggles were different. I made some decisions that led me away from the path that I know I should have gone down. I got into drugs. I got into alcohol. I got into things that took me away from what I knew best and what was best for me. And I allowed myself to be distracted enough to realize I'm not that good. When Peter was with Jesus, I'm sure he felt like Superman. There was nothing he could do wrong. And Jesus had them covered in him while he walked. Because if they fell short, Jesus could pick it up. But now Jesus is gone. So they thought. Because he died. And in Peter's heart, it was worse for him. Because he didn't have a chance to tell Jesus, I'm sorry. He didn't have a chance to tell Jesus that, God, yes, I denied you like you said I would, but God, I'm sorry. I was wrong. I didn't mean to. I just need another chance to tell you that I didn't mean to. I'm sorry. I lost both my parents in the last 12 years, both of them. And neither time was I able to be there physically and say anything before they went on to glory. And that still eats me. Now, my parents were saved. I know they were. I know their hearts were right with God. So I have no fear about where they are. But the thing that hurts me the most is I wasn't able to like hold their hand to pray with them or anything in those last few moments. My dad died suddenly. And for my mother, honestly, I did not want to see her in that state because of how I saw my father pass or at the end of his time. And I just believed God because she's a fighter. I believed God she was going to just pull out of it. But she didn't. So for me, my heart always aches for the fact that I wasn't able to just say, hey, Ma, I love you. Dad, I love you. Or to hear them say it before they left. So I understand completely how Peter feels. The one person that showed me love, the one person that taught me so many things, the one person that told me I could be more than just a fisherman. I denied him at his greatest point of need. And I acted like I didn't even know who he was. And never had a chance to say, I'm sorry. The crazy thing in the scriptures, they say that after he did that, Jesus walked past him. One of the synoptic gospels displays that in their words. But you know the good thing about Jesus? That he's never too far. He's never too far away. And he's never far from love for you, the individual. For each and every one of us, Jesus has a heart for love for all of us. His heart is full of love for all of us. There is nothing that we can say or do that'll tear us away from Jesus. The only thing that tears you away from Jesus is you. You choose not to go back. You choose not to accept his love. You choose not to do what he's asked. Now, if you walk with me to John, in John 21, you'll find Peter and the boys fishing. They're out on the boat fishing. Bible says they're about 200 feet away from the shore, fishing. Or was it about 300 feet? Yeah. It's about 300 feet from the shore, fishing. So they're out fishing, doing what they know to do, what their professions have taught them to do. Wasn't catching much of anything. And this is after Jesus died and has come back, and he's shown himself a couple of times to a few people. But he asked for Peter in one of the meetings. Then he went to go find him. And while they were out there fishing, they didn't recognize who he was, because at this particular time, he was in his new form. So just off of the visual of who he was, they did not recognize him in many occasions until he showed himself to them. And this was no different situation. He rolled up on the beach. Hey, how y'all doing out there? Doing okay. Y'all catch anything? Nah, not really. Cast your nets on the other side. Okay, let's see. They cast their nets. And the Bible says they had more fish in their net. They had so much fish in their net that they could barely hold it. Now, Jesus did this once before. And when they saw that, they realized that's our Lord. That's Jesus. And once again, Peter being the child that he is, he puts on his garment, the Bible says, jumps into the water, and swims that 300 feet back to the shore. The Bible says the others stayed in the boat, dragging the net of fish in. And when they get to the shore, they say Jesus already has a fire burning, some fish. He says, hey, bring some of that fish you just caught. Bring it on in. They sit and they have their little fish dinner. They're sitting there talking and chilling. And if you go down to John 21 and 15, the 15th verse says, so when they had eaten breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me more than these? He said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. And then Jesus said to him, feed my lambs. Now, the translation of feed my lambs is to pasture my lambs. Lambs in the Bible has always been the children of God. It has always been the representation of the body of Christ, your lamb and sheep. But he told Peter to feed my lambs. He said, pasture my lambs. Well, when you pasture a lamb, you find a place for them to go. You lead them to that place and you let them get nourishment. That's what you do with lambs. That's how you pasture lambs. So Jesus told him, basically, one time, the first time, get back to your future. Get back to the thing that I told you you were going to do in the first place. This fishing thing is the old you. There's a new you. And you know how to do what I've already taught you to do. So what I need you to do is get back to business as usual. Now, Jesus being who he is. He said to him again a second time, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me? He said, Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. And he said to him, Tend my sheep. Now, the funny thing is, the sheep is a little different here. The sheep here, according to the Hebrew word that they use here, one of the definitions of the Hebrew word that they use here is any four-legged animal that grazes or pastures. Any. So the first time he said specifically, feed my lambs. Then he said, tend my sheep, which is a whole nother situation. Because when he says to tend my sheep, it's in a supervisory capacity, not only feeding, but ruling over them. He was expressing the full scope of a pastoral oversight over the people of, or the children of God at that point, the people that he would come in contact with, that would be the children of God. He was supposed to have some type of pastoral leadership or ruling over those people at this point. And Peter says once again, I'm sorry, no, he told him, also. Jesus said once again, he said to him the third time, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me? The Bible says here that Peter was grieved because he said it to him the third time. Do you love me? And he said to him, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. And Jesus said to him, feed my sheep. Which goes back to pasture. So Jesus specifically told him to feed, or to feed a specific group of people. Then he told him to pasture a larger group of people. Then he said, once you pasture them, you're going to have to feed them again. And get them to where they need to be so that they're not malnourished and they're not in a position where they lack the knowledge and understanding that they're supposed to have to be my sheep. I said all that I'm saying tonight because Peter denied him three times. Jesus told him it was going to happen, so he knew it was going to happen before it happened. He gave him the opportunity to kind of get himself straight before he got into that situation, but he was so headstrong, he knew he was strong enough to stand against what was coming. And he failed. He failed drastically, horribly. But God being God, showed up and found him where he was, back doing what he knew to do because it was comfortable. It was something he was familiar with. How many times have we found ourselves in places of familiarity only because that's where we felt we could win? That's where we felt confident. Even though it's not the place that God has designed for you. It's not the path that God has made for you. You chose that path. And because of its familiarity, you decided to go back to that path when the path that God chose for you got a little hard. God never said the path that he would put you on would be easy. God never said, whatever you do for me, I'm going to take all the stress and the pain and the issues away. Never said that. But he did say, my burdens are light. My yoke is easy and my burdens are light. And I believe he said that because you never do it by yourself. Jesus is always there. Whether you see, feel, hear him or not, he's always there. He's always there to comfort you. He's always there to be your friend. Even when he's silent, he's still there. Sometimes you have to find that window. You have to find that door. But he's there, speaking in a still, soft voice. A lot of times we don't hear that voice because we're so inundated with everything else that's going around. We don't sit still enough to hear the voice of God. And even here, and I skipped that part, when Jesus showed up and he told them to throw the net on the other side, Peter was on the boat. But they had to tell him that that was the Lord. He heard what was going on, but he was so distracted within his feelings that the Bible says they had to tell him that God was on the shore and he just performed another miracle. That's how distracted he was. Distracted in his own thoughts of failure. Distracted in his own thoughts of frustration. Distracted in his own thoughts of woe is me. To the point where Jesus here had to wake him up three times just to say, hey, dude, do what I told you to do. Now, of course, Jesus said it in the nice, sweet spirit that he has. But on the flip side, Jesus was saying, get back to your future. This is what I've designed for you. This is your future. Fishing on a boat is no longer your future. Jesus is saying to him here, I'm getting ready to leave. And I need you to be what it is you are supposed to be for the coming church. Because without Peter, there are a lot of people that wouldn't get saved. Remember on the day of Pentecost, that was probably the largest number of people to get saved in one shot. And it was all because Peter wasn't afraid to stand up and say something in the midst of that situation. Tonight, as I close, like Jesus, I'm saying, get back to your future. Get back to what you know God has called you to. Get back to what you know in God. Don't allow life circumstances. Don't allow what's going on around us, COVID, sicknesses, whatever it is, to keep you from being everything that God called you to be. Doesn't matter how old you are. Doesn't matter how young you are. Doesn't matter your background. Doesn't matter your past. All that matters is that you are listening to the voice of God right now. That's saying, feed my lambs. Tend to my sheep. Feed my sheep. He's asking you, do you love me? And if you love me, you'll keep his commandments. Well, for everybody listening, get back to your future. Get back to what you know God has called you to. And if you're not sure what God has called you to, ask. The Bible tells us to seek and you'll find. Knock and the door shall be open. If you ask, you shall receive. If you're not sure, ask. He always answers. God bless you. And on behalf of Bishop and the Mount Calvary Christian Center Church of God in Christ, we thank you for joining us tonight. Come back next week. Matter of fact, join us this Sunday at 10 o'clock, right here on Bishop's page on Mount Calvary, CC.com. and also on YouTube, on our Mount Calvary Christian Center YouTube channel at 10 o'clock on Sunday morning. And then we'll be back here next week, 7:30. God bless you. Grace and peace.